So, afternoon. Since most of the participants today in Seattle are from the U.S., I'd like to start off by introducing Calgary and why we are often at the forefront of pipeline inspection. Calgary's is from Alberta, one of Canada's two landlocked provinces, just east of the Rocky Mountains at the Green Arrow there. And Alberta is Canada's economic powerhouse with its highest salaries and fastest growing cities. Calgary today has four times the population it had when I was born there in 1958. Investors worldwide, but mostly from the United States, have poured over $200 billion of construction into our economy in the last few decades. And it wasn't because of ecotourism to see the last wild herd of buffalo on Earth. It was because of a certain special something we have more of than, well, anybody. The money that's poured in actually also brings in the oil curse. Our costs have doubled in the last 9 years. They were already shocking to a lot of people from the southern United States because our mains have to be buried 10 feet deep. Tina's got me beat, 12. They've gone from $10,000 to up to $25,000 to do a single dig, whether it's a main break or a service repair. Our replacement costs have gone up in the last just 9 years from $200 to $400 per foot. So we're kind of halfway between Alaska and Kentucky in more ways than one. Now, there's a special infrastructure we need to bring you all that oil, pipes. It not only takes about 10 to 15% more energy, it takes just a lot of pipes to turn tar into oil. It takes even more pipes to move that oil around, and it takes pipes with no holes in them to move it around without releasing poisons and flammables. And on all sorts of corrosion protection thing, all the hydrocarbon industries are so far ahead of water, it's really not funny. Notoriously, it takes a couple of three barrels of water to make one barrel of oil, so a lot of those pipes contain water. Even a tiny fraction of that $200 billion going into R&D on pipe integrity supported a healthy new industry in pipeline inspection, which is why PECA's home office is in Edmonton and Pure Technology started in Calgary. From Edmonton, Dave Russell started off inspecting the thousands of copper tubes that form the body of heat exchangers in petrochemical process plants, where every hour of downtime is solid gold. It was only years later, as he thought to expand the business, that he realized the tool was just perfect already for inspecting copper water service lines for pits and pinholes. That's their example thing there, that they'll push that little sensor in the front back and forth through that pipe that's got some drilled pits and holes into it, and you can actually hear the signal going "yew" as it goes past the hole. The service expanded beyond Russell and PECA decades ago, and we hire a little company called RTD to open the service line up inside the customer basement, push the tool by hand as far as the service valve, and we can generally squeeze past it to our side of the service. 2001, Calgary got this cluster of copper service pinholes that had us digging up half the front yards on individual streets, where like five houses on one block would have the holes. That brought out TV cameras, a lot of upset customers, and a lot of worry because in Calgary, on your side of the property line, you have to pay for the dig. The inspections were a vastly cheaper way to tell whether the dig was already needed or imminent due to deep pits or still avoidable with some quick zinc anode protection. Dave Russell went on to develop the Hydroscope, now called the Sea Snake. I may call it the Hydroscope once or twice. And they love to give you these explanations from the top picture, and you've heard some of them this morning about how they work. As far as I care, the thing works by fairy dust and hand waves. The PhDs are always wanting to talk about that stuff. I only want to talk about two things. Is the report you're going to hand me for my $500,000 correspond with the pits and holes that I'm going to find when I yard it out and sandblast it? And secondly, how difficult is it to get that string of pearls in the front there in and out of a hydrant and through our mains without breaking anything or scratching them up in the internal coatings? Charles' predecessors, Gregor Kazushner and Bill Eng, and myself, we were satisfied on the accuracy concerns about the Sea Snake by the year 2000. We did exactly that. We Sea Snaked well over a kilometer of mains, pulled them all out, sandblasted them, counted every pit, checked the depth of every pit. Our AWWE paper on the subject now has a satisfying dozen-odd citations in the literature, and it's available here or by email PDF. If long rows of numbers bore you, the short version is that it worked well enough in 2000 for our needs, and it certainly works better now as they've had a relentless R&D improvement of the tool. When it said through hole, and this is back in 2000, 80% of the time there was a through hole, and almost all of the other 20% were very deep pits. The shallower the pit, however, the greater the error bars. If they say it's 40% of the way through, it might be 65, it might be 25. Because of the analysis cost, they only pick out the three deepest pits per pipe length, and they so they only caught about half the shallow pits, but they caught all of the really deep pits and where there's less than a third of the wall thickness left, the ones you care about. So that concern solved, I won't discuss it anymore. The rest is the field problem and making it work in practice. You need three hydrants. You've got to put the tool in through one, shown in upper left, where they take off the hydrant and put on that blue launching device, which has a cable pulley on top, the stabilizer bar just below it to brace against the their trailer. You can see that at lower right, because they have to pull back on that cable with up to 3,000 pounds of force to get the tool back out of the mains after it's finished its trip by water pressure. You generally have to deprive two valve circuits of water for a day. You also need a discharge hydrant, lower left, and with a hose on it because we can't put chlorinated water into the storm sewers anymore. And then you need the supply hydrant upper right there with comes from a third valve circuit within the hose distance of the launch. Some jobs we've had to give up on before we ever got to the field because you just couldn't find close enough hydrants. So every run requires, like that picture, a lot of advanced planning on the map as to exactly where you're going to put out a water and where you're going to get the water from. And we've got to do notifications to customers, all that. For us, every job starts with foam pigs, which you stuff down that launcher device and force through the whole run to the discharge hydrant. With our internal scale, the first ones come out in small pieces, and it may take a few before you even get to large pieces. When a foam pig comes out in only one or two, you've got the courage to put the tool through without worrying about it getting stuck. We've done over 280 sea snake runs now. We've had to dig a tool out twice, and we think we're doing pretty well with that. We've learned a lot. Don't think we'll be seeing too much more of it. If the foam pigs keep shredding, we send through the one I call the roller bar ball, the 1970s film poster in upper left there. I was high school. We hate that one, though, because a lot of our old mains have an internal coating they called coal tar enamel, a thick bitumen. If you scratch it up too badly, the main discharge can start to smell like diesel, and you can't put it back in service. Most of those we cleared up after we flushed for a few days, but one we had to replace after it kept smelling like road paving for 2 weeks of flushing. And then the report came back and said it was in great shape. It can take up to four people to gently put in the tool. In the middle, our field services tech pushing the tool down with a bar. To his right, the PICA technician feeding in the sea snake. Far right, another to keep the cable from tangling. And the fourth guy is required by our union rules that say somebody must ruin every field photograph with the big grin and the Fonzie thumbs up thing. Jesus. The rest is PICA's problem, and they alternate slow progress with pullbacks to go over some spots twice. Runs can take several hours, and you don't want to rush. That's when you get the tool stuck. A few months later, PICA sends you those multi-page reports with pie charts with the mix of shallow and deep pits and so forth. They put a lot of store by the average wall thickness graphed here that gives you sort of the general health of the main. But I have to replace mains based on the chance of having a number of those $25,000 repairs. And over half our repairs aren't for the full circular main breaks, that question of what's a break and what's a leak. They're just leaks that have popped through corrosion through holes. So my favorite sea snake graph is this one, which puts it all together in one big picture. The they number their pipe lengths in 10, so there aren't 1,130 pipe lengths there. There's 113, about 2,200 feet of pipe. The light blue bar for each pipe length is the average wall thickness in percent. You can see the 100% line across the top. Dark blue bars are new. I'm not terribly sure what they're good for. They give you the maximum full circle wall thickness. That's where the pipe's not going to break. The blue tick mark is the minimum circular wall where you would be most likely to get a full circular, and if it's extremely low. And the three dots down the length of each bar are the three deepest pits I mentioned, just the three for each pipe length because of the sure cost of the analysis when they get all the raw data back into the office. I prefer to show sea snake results entirely in the GIS, where they can be compared to other map issues like traffic and customer locations. This is my big picture symbology that reduces the whole hydroscope report down to one key performance indicator, which I have named badness, to emphasize how approximate and experimental such attempts at a single number for a complex group of data is. My current attempt at a useful badness measure is just take the number of through holes in the run by five, times 5, the number of deep pits times 2, and the medium depth pits by 1. You can get numbers easily into the hundreds, particularly for the longer runs. As you can see on the full map, Calgary is now likely to have a sea snake run within several blocks of any location that you're worried about. A sea snake run on a main gives you one of the first analysts called a benchmark for all the mains of similar material and diameter within a few blocks of it. You can't sea snake everything. We've almost got 10% of our metallic distribution system sea snake now, and for every one we've done, we've got a pretty good guess at the 3 or 4 or 5 mains around it. So we're getting towards where we've got enough done. Now, if you zoom in to the neighborhood level, you can start to see a second GIS symbology that gives you that average wall thickness by vastly exaggerating the line weight. 70% remaining wall on average is very thin wall indeed at high break risk. So I show those pipe lengths as skinny as strings. And then at the closest zoom level, it turns on the 3 pits per pipe length, color-coded for red, color for under 10%, the legend in upper right there, remaining down to blue, cool. I always do everything from hot to cool. It's for just about any metric I'm trying to show with the GIS. For anything over 70% wall remaining is not a worrisome pit yet, so show that in blue. Now, I'll be showing some research you can do about the overall system health with the sea snake, but the primary reason for picking a main is because it's a concern. Is you want to know about that particular main, not just about the overall health of our system. I basically have 2 strategies for betting $1 million, and that's what we're paid to do, folks. Our total capital budget, that's water and sewer, mind you. But for rehab replacement is about $30 million a year. And basically, I'm betting $30 million a year for people who want $40 million a year back out of it. And they want me to show that, you know, some sort of later on capital expenditure is dropped by that much. So the 2 strategies are, one is if you can come up with a key performance indicator, if you can come up with some sort of single metric number that tells you this one is definitely worse than that one, then the computer picks your program. And the computer does pick quite a bit of our program now. There's ones that are so obvious, this is a really bad main, you don't need a human intervention, it can just be obviously scheduled. And secondly, is you throw vast amounts of data at a human brain until they learn to assimilate it and make the best call on site, what one book called the blink phenomenon. And I use the GIS system to do that. I'm throwing everything at you, the wall thickness, the pit depths, the whole bit. In a single eye blink, and after you've looked at enough sea snake runs, you start saying, oh man, that main's got to go. So, however, the mains you're picking out, the big use of sea snake for us has been the mains that just make you gnaw your fingernails, because they say, we're closing the Center Street Bridge to pave it. That's a really awful thing to do. We can't do it twice. This is your one chance in 30 years to replace it, and I'm sitting there going, the thing's had 2 breaks, one of them last year. Is that the start of a rash, or is that it? And you know, and I have to spend $1 million to replace the main at our costs of $200 a foot. If I'm going to replace it, and if it turns out those were the only 2 holes, I've really just thrown away $1 million. And we sea snaked, and that's a real example. We sea snaked it, and those were the only 2 holes, and I just saved $1 million with a $40,000 sea snake run, 25-to-1 payback. Just wanted to mention the little inset thing there. Those couple of 2011s right here. That was where the breaks occurred in 2011, right beside where there were 2 through holes shown in a sea snake run 6 years earlier. So the sea snake run basically predicted those breaks, but it didn't say when they would happen. And there's a whole bunch of other red dots there. And the thing is, you can tell about the pipe condition, you can't tell about the soil condition. We've got a lot of tight clays where the clay will simply hold the pipe together, whether it's a big main with the wires broken or a little main with through holes and the clay is holding in the graphite plugs. But the thing about what we've observed about it is that once you start to disturb that soil, then you're lost. And what disturbs the soil? Leaks that make it wet, and you digging a giant hole in the ground right beside it and bashing the pipe around. So now that those 2 have started the break run, all of those little red things are going to pop over the next 10 years or so, and it's already scheduled for replacement. But getting to the sort of overall health of the system, is we came up with an extraordinarily cheap way to spot where the bad mains were going to be, At the lower left there is the Geonix resistivity meter. It checks the soil resistivity, its conductance for electricity. And it's a few seconds to do it. You push a button, it waves some electromagnetic fields and fairy dust through the soil and tells you the soil resistivity in ohm centimeters. If it's below 2,000 ohm centimeters, I've colored it red on this map, and we took 100,000 readings. It only cost a few hundred thousand dollars. So we've got one reading in front of every house along all of our metallic mains, over 100,000 readings in the whole city. And where the soil was generally hot, in yellow, is the corrosion-based main breaks, and the blue ones just have a fraction of the number. So the soil resistivity isn't terribly good at predicting the exact location of a main break, but it tells you whether you're on a bad neighborhood or a bad street or not. And there was some difficulty. The National Research Council of Canada, for instance, could not really say that there's a direct correlation between soil resistivity and main breaks because they just sort of found a cloud on the map and it didn't really have a very good R squared, although you sort of got more main breaks as you got very low resistivities. But with the sea snake stuff, we were able to get much more granular data than that because you're getting the pit depth and you're getting a lot more pits out of a sea snake run than you actually have main breaks. You might have 5 breaks on the main and 100 through holes. We actually pulled out a pipe where that it had broken 5 times. We pulled it out, sandblasted it. There were 100 holes in that main, just only 5 had popped before we pulled it out. So with that much greater amount of data, to explain the slide, here's the sea snake run along this street. And this is the soil resistivities. The very low soil resistivities are in red. Again, I always use hot to cold, and really good soil resistivities. So those can change quite dramatically just down a single block. And now that we've done these 280-odd sea snake runs, I've got 15,541 pits I know about on along 70 miles of our mains. And I was able to find the correlation. I had to go to kind of big statistical bins to do it. Again, I too got a cloud of points that wasn't really very tight or didn't have a good R squared or anything on just going X is soil resistivity and Y is pit depth. So I simplified the statistical bins down into the percentage of all pits that were deep in blue, that were medium in red, and were shallow in green. Now, the sea snake only gives you those 3 deepest pits. They don't find very many shallow pits. So with soil resistivity along the bottom, the number of really shallow ones didn't change, but that's an artifact of the way the data is gathered. What's really clear now is there's 3 regimes, not just above and below 2,000 ohm centimeters, but up to 2,000. You're about one-third deep pits and two-thirds shallow pits. But then as you go from 2,000 to 4,000 ohm centimeters, that drops away down to only about one-tenth deep pits, and about 80% odd are medium-depth pits. So now we've kind of got 3 resistivity regimes. We can sort of assign a different risk, whether it's 0 to 2,000, 2 to 4,000, or above 4,000. And so now that's given us yet another tool we can use very, very cheaply with just the soil resistivity data that cost a few hundred thousand for an entire city. And then lastly, the question is, like, you're welcome to go around inventing your own badness metric, and I could invent 6 more with multiplying this by that, and wall thickness gives you 10 points or whatever you want. But what does it all relate to back in terms of the number of breaks? Again, I went to very simple statistical groups. Is depending on badness along the bottom of your sea snake run, what are the odds that main has only 1 to 3 breaks, 4 to 6, 7 to 10, or more than 10 breaks? By the time you're up to a badness of 400, none of those mains had only 1 to 3 breaks, and 60% of them had over 10 breaks. So while it's a rough metric, and it shouldn't be given too much credence and used too heavily, it is a useful metric to get you started and know that that's the area you've got to zoom in on. So that's our distribution main part, and Charles will be taking over for our feeder main part. And the handoff thing is that we were feeling very good about this around 2003, getting to be 2004. And I said to my fellow engineer on the subject, you know, as we spend all this money on the distribution system, we got it all inspected, we don't spend a penny on our big mains. He said, don't worry, one of them will have a catastrophic break, and then we'll have $1 million a year. The man who spends $1 million a year, Charles Bell.
So at that point, we pretty much figured our feeder mains were bulletproof. which was until a cold January night about 9 years ago. So we had a 48-inch C301L class pipe that catastrophically failed. You can see right in here, that is the roof of a car that had to be rescued by the fire department. Thankfully, this happened on Sunday night, in essentially the middle of the night. If this happened during rush hour, we would have had fatalities to deal with. So there's what the pipe looked like afterwards. It was about minus 35 for 2 weeks straight, and the cold didn't help. The result of this, we had 100,000 people at low water pressure. We lost 5 million gallons of water, and this was a pipe that at this point was only 24 years old. So we did some forensics and found that our main culprit was sulfate attack, and that sulfate-resistant concrete is exactly that. It's resistant, but it's not sulfate-proof. It's good up to about 2,000 parts per million, but our soils here were over 5,000, and the wetting and drying cycles of groundwater that fluctuates added to that. It eats up the concrete. You can take a banana knife and just kind of jab it right into the concrete, and it just slides in like butter. Goes through that, and then you've got the wires exposed to be able to just get corroded away. So our feeder main network, the breakdown on the concrete side is we got about 85 miles of PCCP lined, about 6 miles of embedded, and then another 50 miles of bar wrap pipe. So when we were looking at trying to determine where we wanted to do our inspections, knowing that our first break came from soil sulfates, we went around the city starting to look at where do we have sulfate problems. We started an annual program punching holes about every 1,500 feet along our concrete mains, and then went down to 150 feet for more detailed areas where we were looking at trying to help determine replacement extents or things like that. We've also had new construction areas where we've got our engineers to supply us with their geotechnical reports to add those sulfates into our database. Because Calgary's soils are essentially a mishmash of glacial till, we found that the sulfates are very pocketed. Spots 15 feet away from each other can vary from above 4,000 parts per million to below 1,000. So from that, we started doing our inspections. Left shows Pure Technologies P-Wave robot. And to the right, we have the former Pressure Pipe Inspection Company's pipe crawler. Pure purchased PPIC in August of 2010. We had planned to do a comparison between the technologies, but the buyout happened before we got to that. From what we had from them, the Pure had better robotics, we found. PPIC had better analysis. Now we've kind of got the best of both worlds to go with that. So we began inspecting our C301 lined and embedded pipe in areas with poor soils, and we've managed to prevent 4 failures thus far. We use robotics to be safer. Our fire department will only go 300 feet down a pipe to rescue somebody. So as opposed to doing manned, which is cheaper, the safety factor just, it makes more sense for us to go with the robots. One of the challenges with that, though, is getting access into the pipe. Because the only places where we've got our access plates brought up to grade are where we have air valves. Aside from that, we've had to go on and put manhole barrels and everything onto it. Secondly, all of our most interesting pipes are the ones that are most critical and can't be shut down easily. So it's challenging trying to do that when you're in low water demands. So from that, we did finite element analysis on some of our pipes to try to determine what level or where we could go with the pipes and know how many wire breaks we have before things start to fall apart. We had kind of an engineering judgment that 50 wire breaks was kind of our limit, and the risk curves kind of show what our safety factor was and showed that we were a little bit too liberal, and we've dropped it down to 35 wire breaks as kind of our limit now. So with our assessment process, if we've got anything essentially under 10 wire breaks, we'll just plan a reinspection. 10 to 35, we'll monitor it. And then over 35, we'll verify, just because sometimes calls are incorrect, excavate and repair. So with monitoring, we're just listening for the rate that the wires are breaking. So you've got your baseline inspection, you add the rate from monitoring, and you can kind of get a lifespan before you reach that 35 threshold that we work with. So we've had each of these kind of systems in place and in operation. So for acoustic fiber optic, we had this installed in 2004 on the line that broke in earlier. We get real-time email alerts whenever there's a wire slip or wire break. We assume the worst, so anytime there's any kind of sound, we assume it's a break, just so that we're being more conservative. It's a fairly expensive installation with high upfront costs, but it has a low incremental cost for expanding length that's being monitored. The fiber optic can be put in dry when the main is depressurized and drained, or it can be put in wet under pressure. And it can't pass through valves, so you actually have to take the fiber optic up around the valve and then back in on the other side. The other monitoring system we've had is acoustic emission testing, which we had installed in 2008. And basically, you hydrovac down to the main, install in a 6-inch PVC casing. Then with the long-handled glue gun, essentially, they just glue an accelerometer onto the surface of the pipe. When you have two of them, if any wires break in between, it can triangulate the position, and they have a range of about 300 feet. Alternatively, you can put a hydrophone inside the pipe, which essentially doubles the range on that. It's fairly inexpensive for installation, but it has a high cost to expand to a long length. We were focused on C301 until this happened in July 2011. This was a C303 rupture that was 15 feet from the corner of a garage. So we are now in the business of removing garages if anybody else is interested. This was a 1978 pipe, again, not that old, and forensics pointed to soil sulfates as being the main culprit. So from that, we worked with Pier Technologies to inspect Bar-Wrap pipe. The picture on the left is their current setup in their G2 robot. The picture on the right is what their initial test bed was for inspecting it. We've also trialed this on steel pipe to be able to inspect as well, because this inspection looks at both the can and the bars in the pipe, very similar to just looking at the steel pipe itself. One thing to note with C303 pipe, it is semi-rigid. There is no specified amount of deflection allowed based on loading, but we found a pipe that's 10% out of round and still functioning. We've got concerns, areas especially like this, where it's compressed to the point that the mortar on the inside has buckled. It's challenging for the robot to drive through, but our main concern is if it's buckled on the inside, what's the mortar doing on the outside, and is there any more corrosion protection on the pipe? From that, we've also looked at risk curves on the C303 pipe, which is a lot more more confusing than just on the pre-stress pipe, because you're dealing with broken bars, the structural integrity loss due to corrosion, and the deflection increase due to corrosion. There's also no current ability to monitor. So we attempt to conduct two inspections a year, each totaling about 3 miles, one in the spring before high water demand, one in the fall afterwards. One of the hardest things is trying to book equipment, because a lot of times it's down in Kentucky. And also trying to not make sure we're working during the coldest months of the year, because at minus 40, nothing works right. When we're planning to do our replacement, a lot of times we'll do hydroblasting on our lined pipe or on our Bar-Wrap pipe, because you can go through, it's essentially 15,000 PSI water jetting that just removes all of the mortar off the outside. You can look at the wires themselves. We've had a couple spots where there's been odd welds manufactured onto the pipe. We've had places where they've done a patch on the can before putting the wires on top, and they were called as wire breaks, but after verifying that they weren't actually wire breaks, we were able to re-coat them, put mortar on top, and bury them essentially in place and save ourselves the construction costs of actually replacing these pieces of pipe. From that point, we go through our standard repair and getting the pipe back into service. So now I'll move on to a couple new technologies that we have trialed. We did trial Pier's Pipe Diver. This was on a pre-stressed and bar-wrapped combination pipeline from our wastewater plants, 8 miles long. The main challenges we had were due to poor records. We didn't have the lay sheets. We didn't have the pipe drawings. So firstly, the tool ended up surfacing in a different spot that we didn't know existed, where the... we had crews running around in the middle of the night in the industrial area trying to find this new gravity discharge to get the tool out. And secondly, without the actual pipe details, a lot of the results were listed as anomalous. They didn't know how many wire breaks were there. So it took removing a piece of pipe and doing some validation before we were actually able to get results on that. We've trialed Echologics pipe integrity testing, where they put the microphones on different valve stems and introduce a noise in the pipe, literally by banging on a hydrant with a rubber mallet, and then tell you the average wall thickness. We've placed this on runs where we already had sea snake results, and we've found some minor correlations. So it's not the greatest, but it is very inexpensive comparatively. And then lastly, with Pure Smart Ball, we've extensively used this. You need to be in a situation where you've got at least 1 foot per second of flow. We've ran into a couple of situations without that, and the ball literally just drops into the main and stays there. But you basically take it, put it in through a 4-inch access, as shown on the left. They kind of plunge it into the main. It floats down the main to the other side, where they've got another one with a big net and a camera, so they can see it go into the net, and pull it back out. It's been very reliable for us. We've had it on a 10-mile-long inspection, and where they called the main, they were off by 4 inches, or where they called the leak on the main, they were off by 4 inches. And that basically covers what we've got.